Next up, we have our speaker, Jade. She is the CTO and co-founder of Heese Robotics, a Lyon-based startup developing autonomous customer service robots for shops, airports, museums, and offices. Heese, if I'm saying this correctly, Heese, is a mobile robot. It's robust and autonomous and equipped with attractive means of interacting with humans and without the complexity of advanced humanoids. It's a social robot intended to share our personal space, interact and provide emotional engagement, and entertain and entertainment. Jade is also an advisor to the European Commission and regularly appears on French TV. And I don't know if you know, but French is a mandatory language for Romanian school children growing up. So we're going to do this presentation in French, right? No. She's the co-founder of Lyon is AI movement and featured in Forbes Europe's Top 50 Women in Tech, speaking today on From Airports to Museums, How Robotics Can Enhance Customer Satisfaction. Please welcome Jade Monté.
Thank you, everybody. Do you hear me? Hear me better? Yes. Okay, thank you so much for being such an amazing and interactive audience and something swung. Okay, great. I try to do my best not so that you hear my breath, my breathing. So today I will speak about you about robotics. AI is a wonderful thing, and embodiment of AI in our daily lives is the most wonderful thing. Not only on our phones, but only on objects that can add value and can help you everywhere you go. So, as Trevor said, so I'm a co-founder and CTO, so Chief Technology Officer of Heese, and I also work at the European Commission to evaluate research and development project about robotics and AI. I am also, part of my activities is investing in early stage technology startups and advising some VC funds about technology, and that is something that I really like. Being entrepreneur and knowing the other side of things is also quite interesting. And our major goal is that the ecosystem needs startups, larger companies, entrepreneurs, and academics, so that we can have projects together. And of course, follow me on Twitter. This is my most up-to-date network at LinkedIn. And sadly, I'm not quite human. I'm also part of a robot. I do not sleep very much. So at Heese, what we do is we are a team of 25 people. And because we think that making a product for real people implies having real people on our team, we decided to have a very diverse team. So not only white males, but also female people. And from different countries, we have 5 nationalities in our team, which I think for me is not so big, could be bigger, trying to expand it. And with these incredibly skilled people, we have a lot of different expertise that we put in our products. And with that team, we reached what we call TRL1 to TRL9 in less than 3 years. TRL is technology readiness level. This is a scale that we use to evaluate the maturity of a technology product. So, usually TRL1 is an idea on paper. TRL9 is a commercialized product, and you have everything around that product to make it sustainable. And we did that by taking the needs of our customers into account. And our customers were primarily, at the beginning, hypermarket chains and shopping malls. And they were thinking they were wasting the time of the salespeople, because the salespeople spend 1/3 of their time not selling things. And that is a complete waste of money. They spend the time mostly by answering questions about directions. And the most asked questions is, where are the toilets? I think everybody can relate to that by coming to a shopping mall or shop. And they also noticed that we had an increase in the sales if we equipped a screen with a payment, a screen or an information kiosk. Sales goes up because people trust machines more than they trust humans. So that was quite interesting. And we said, okay, you want a robot in your shopping mall because robots are cool. But if robots are cool and useful, then it will be a win-win situation for you and for us. So we decided to chase the perfect product, because make or buy is always a decision, and if you can buy something that already exists, it will save you time and money. So we tried some robots around the world, and I have difficulties with that. We tried some robots around the world. So Furo is a robot from Korea. It's nicely looking compared to other robots. It's tall, it has a big screen. It has all the prerequisites that for our customers were quite interesting. But it's hard to integrate because to read the documentation, you have to speak Korean. So for us, it was quite an ago. Then we looked over Sandbot, which was very popular at the time because it's quite cheap, $8,000, which for a robot is quite cheap. But then for $8,000, you have a robot that goes like to your knees and you have to bend to read the things that are on the screen. So not made for European people, only for Asian people that are less taller than us. Then we looked, if Asia doesn't work, then why not look over the US? And the US had an amazing piece of technology called the Relay Robot, which is a room service robot. It navigates, it has a screen, it's nice and looking, and it works. It's something big in robot, it's a robot that works. But it was hard to integrate because it needs a lot of sensors around the building so the robot knows where it is. And the price of the installation of the sensors is twice or three times more the price of the robot. For our customers, it was a complete no-go. And then, of course, the Pepper robot, the most well-known, cute humanoid robot ever, and mostly used in TV commercials and as a sales assistant because it can dance and has nice moves. But it doesn't move because it breaks. It has tiny fingers, you touch the finger breaks. So it wasn't safe enough for our customers. With that in mind, we decided to design our robot, gaining all the knowledge of having seen all the competitors and worked with all these robots. So our robot, Easy, would be able to welcome and guide people, would be tall enough to be seen from the distance, and with navigation capabilities that were very well thought for the places where the robot would be put. And also it would be easy to integrate, because documentation will be in English, so worldwide usable. And we wanted to use all the state-of-the-art technologies so that non-robotics people could integrate it. So meet Easy. So this is part of our marketing advertisement. So mobile and accessible, because even people in wheelchairs can use the robot. It is something that was important for us. Easy to use for random people in a shopping mall, from kids to elderly people. We noticed that everyone can use it. And for our customers, easy to manage. We build a platform so that they can access remotely their robot and manage it. Install application, install a new screensaver, change the logo, change the colors. Everything as easy as maintaining a website with WordPress, for example. So this is the robot in action. It is in a French shopping mall, and here it is in a train station. In the shopping mall, the goal was to advertise and enlist people into the fidelity program. And in the train station, it's something nicer for us because it's giving direction and information about the trains and bus and cabs, and then guiding people to specific point of interest. We also did integrate the robot with the elevator, so the robot can call an elevator in Athens whenever a user needs to go to the elevator, and then accompany the user to the specific elevator that the robot did call, based on availability. So the fun part for Tech is here, what's inside? Inside is firstly 100 days, yes? Yes. We didn't use 3D cameras because 3D cameras are one, expensive, two, they overheat a lot, and so the picture gets a little deformation and it cannot be reliable. We are using a LiDAR and ultrasound and laser, so we are fusing a lot of sensors. What? Sadly, I cannot discuss in that specific details what we are using because... Okay. Okay, I think we can speak about some algorithm later so that I can explain better what else is also on the robot, because SLAM is not the only useful thing. So first, we did prototype for 100 days. So it involves a lot of soldering and 3D printing and rushing during weeks. And finally, 100 days after starting the first sketches, we shipped the robot to an international fair in the US to gain our first customer interest and traction. Thanks to that, we had in 2017 the first customer interactions. So in a big football stadium where he did some animation during the break for children and their parents. And we tested the way that the robot could move, and it was quite not good. So we had to redesign a lot. And then in our biggest customer, Leclerc, which is a big shopping mall chain in a hypermarket chain in France and in the world, total, these are highway rest station where the robot had to provide security and safety information to drivers in a fun way so that they are not feeling obligated to hear the safety information, but they are happy to do so. Also on train station, and it's in that particular train station since a year and a half now, and still working, and people still use it every day. Fun fact, the first day the robot was in that train station was on a national strike day. You know, in France, we are quite, it's casual for us to strike. And 2 years ago, we had a particular strike at the train company, and a strike that lasted 2 days per week, but frequently for 6 months. It was quite a complicated time for all companies and travelers in France. And that robot was there for the first time during the first day of strike. And that train station and that particular company has usually a satisfaction rate of 42% max. And on that day, the satisfaction rate that we observed on the robot was 85%. They didn't understand why the people were so happy. It was a strike, that there were no train. But because there were no train and no staff member able to give information to the travelers, the robot was the only reliable thing they could access in that train station. And that was something that went towards them, giving them information. They didn't have to search. The robot was just there and giving them information. It's quite a small train station. It's quite a small translation, and people usually interact with it during 35, 38 seconds, so this is quite short time and allows multiple people to access information. And we had to give the SNCF, our customers, the raw data so that they could believe us. They could believe the 85% satisfaction rate was true. And because of that, this is quite successful, and they have the robot for a year and a half, and I think it will be lasting. And we are discussing with other train stations so that we can do the same at other train stations. Every train station is different. You cannot just say, hey, my product will be in every train station in France. Everything is different and everything is political. We had also Vinci at their facilities, more in an office manager kind of way, welcoming people and guiding the visitors into a particular meeting room. And the same at Emotion. This is a facilities pretty much like Leclerc, but it was in their office. And that's why we do not have pictures, because it was an internal use. So after a year of customer validation and refinement and testing, we decided it was the time to industrialize our robot. And for a year, my research and development team, very much likely to work with 3D printing and ingenious things and solving problems very fast, had to switch completely to go to a process where things takes time. Because you deal with manufacturing processes, and you deal with plasturgy, and you deal with foundry people, and everything takes time. So that was very difficult for us all, and we did speed up the process by prototyping a lot on our 3D printers, large 3D printers that can print up to 1 cubic meter. So that is quite interesting and nice, and this is what allowed us to go that fast also. And a year later, we received our first parts to assemble the robots in-house. Because we have low volumes, we had to internalize manufacturing and assembling process, because for external manufacturer, the volumes were not high enough. So we also had to learn a lot so that we could have quality control and testing facilities and also electronics approved devices so that we couldn't harm the robot that we were building. And on the 21st of December last year, we assembled and tested our first industrialized robot here. Tim was quite very proud. We are working with a constellation of 25 different suppliers, supplying us with parts that we designed or parts that we buy, depending on the criticality and the cost of these parts. Majority in France, majority in Europe, some in Asia, because there are just some things that you cannot buy in Europe. For example, screens. You have to have an Asian partner to have quality screens, for example. So, on wrapped in a nutshell, it took us 2.5 years of research and development until we had our final product ready for commercialization, normed, tested, and ready to ship to our customers. I promised you to tell you what's inside. We decided to go a lot with technologies that non-robotics people could use. For example, robotics people love to use ROS. This is a robot operating system. But for non-robotics people, it can be tricky because you have a lot of onboarding to do. You have a lot of new things to learn. Instead of that, we decided to have a JavaScript API so that people could do things with the robot very quickly and with little onboarding. For more techie people, we also have a Python API so that they can code hard deep things on the robot. And for the hardware geeks here, we packed the robot with a lot of sensors and we wanted to have a balance between the technology inside and the cost of this technology, because as a company, we have to keep profitable enough so that we keep going. So it was a lot of sourcing and ingenuity so that we can add valuable technologies in it, so that the robot is interesting and fulfills his mission at a correct cost. Part of the design that we did was also to design emotions the robot could convey to attract people, and so that interactions with the robot are not natural, because a robot whose eyes are turning into big red hearts are natural, but it's fun and you want to see it more often. And we also didn't want to have an anthropomorphic robot, because if you fail to humanize the robot correctly, then people have fear about it. They do not feel well about a robot which is failing at mimicking a human. So we rather search for inspiration in the cartoons, for example, Wall-E, Disney, Pixar, so that we can convey emotions without looking like an animal or a human. Part of our effort was also to design the robot management software so that we could have access to the robot everywhere for quality control and for maintenance purposes also, but utmost for our customers, so that they could work with the robot in a very simple manner. We are also looking to integrate more nice options that are asked by our clients, for example, payment terminal. We are working with Atos on that. NFC integration, people ask that often, for example, at office buildings or so on. A back screen to display publicity sales, And a thermal printer also. Some interesting use case that we had. So in that train station, I talk about that a lot because it's where we have the most data, a year and a half of a robot being in a single place, and per day meeting with more than 200 people is quite usual in the robotics world, and we did gain a lot of experience watching how the people did behave with the robot and how the robot was useful for them. So, for example, what this experiment took place in three phases. First, we wanted to know how people would interact with the robot. So a very simple use case that was only the welcoming version, welcoming people, giving them information about the schedule of trains, schedule of buses, and where they could find taxi. This is a small but complicated train station because it's on different levels and the parkings are very far away in that direction. Bus are in that direction and taxis, I've never found them yet. So, and then it was welcoming and guiding to the elevators, with the robot coming to the elevators. And we are working on the third phase, is that the robot can take the elevator with the human and go to the upper level. This is an example of design that we did for our customers. At the shopping mall, this is quite interesting because we were in competition with traditional static kiosks, which are screens usually put in the back, and the mobile app that the hypermarket chain wants the customer to download. But the fact is, nobody wants to download a hypermarket chain application, so they had quite much trouble advertising for it. And so the robot had the exact same content as the application and the mobile and the classic static kiosk. And we observed more than 20 times more interaction with the robot than with traditional kiosk. It's normal because kiosks are far away, they don't move, you don't notice them. But you notice a robot just strolling around after you just paid your groceries. Because it's nice, it's new, and it moves. We have eyes like a tyrannosaur, like a T-Rex. We are attracted by things that are moving. That's why it generated so much more interaction. And 3 times more participants than with the mobile app. It's also normal because we have, in that supermarket chain, we have a lot of people that do not have a mobile app or a smartphone. Elderly people, for example, or younger people, or just people that don't want to pull out a smartphone while doing their groceries. So it was quite interesting. So this was an experiment over 2 months. And a year later, we finished negotiation and they did buy 10 robots for the beginning of 2019. And now we are entering discussion for the batch of robots that can be delivered next year. In the gas station, they did not take our advices on how to communicate and how to design the application for the customers, because they had an internal design agency. And that's why it failed, in our opinion, because it had too many things that the user could do. And if you present the users with 2 options, which are a game or security application, the user will choose security. No, that's what they thought. The user will choose the game and will choose to take a picture with the robot. So it did fail in a way that the robot could not convey the message they wanted. But it was a huge success in terms of people, number of people the robot did interact with. And they gained a popularity contest, like their image was better after than before, and also the staff members were quite cheered by this new staff member that was working with them. So that's quite balance between a fail and a success, and it's a case that I like to discuss because, you know, we're experts in robotics, and sometimes we have a strong opinion about what works or what does not work, because we're working in this field since 10 years. And sometimes customers just say, okay, we have the money for the robot, but we have our internal design agency, and it has to be involved in that. And then this matter of choice. Are they willing to listen to a smaller company, but with more expertise? Or are they just, how can I say that? Lessen the amount of time they spend on that because they have more pressure or important things to do. But it's always important things, and we discuss that with the customer, and they say, okay, next time we will do better. We will propose less things to our clients. So it was also in the museum, we're waiting for the feedback because it was done by our distributor in the Lascaux Museum, which is a big prosthetic museum in France, and they are analyzing the data collected by the robot to determine, okay, what was a success and what could we improve. Next year, we will also be focusing on the hospital market because we are partnering with a big network of hospitals in France so that the robot can be an assistant to the nurse or entertain children while their parents are undergoing some exams or welcoming and guiding at the entrance of the hospitals because hospitals are quite complicated buildings. So my time is up. I thank you for your attention, and I hope to discuss a lot of things with you later.